1 year ago, the Ministry of Foreign Affairs and Trade officially announced the start of negotiations on the FTA between the two countries. This is obviously really big for the people who come to field days. And while negotiations are ongoing, farmers in the UK have shared a concern that a deal could lead to local standards being lowered. Also news overnight that the terms of an FTA between the UK and Australia have been settled upon. We're really delighted to have as our first guest this morning a very special one, British High Commissioner to New Zealand, Laura Clarke.
Morena.
Morena.
Ke te pai ahau.
Well, it's lovely to see you. Thank you so much for coming in, and it's an early start. We're grateful you're here. The UK, you have a stand. Do you have a stand at Field Days?
We have a stand. So anyone who's at Field Days should come and see us. We're in the Mystery Creek Pavilion, stand 50-52, and we're there talking about our trade negotiations, about our climate change ambitions, and agritech collaboration between the UK and New Zealand, and we're profiling five really exciting agritech companies who, of course, can't be here physically but are dialing into various events.
And
as
so,
well.
Would these be agritech companies that would work with New Zealand or that New Zealand would go to in conventional client relationships?
I mean, either. You know, it's about collaboration, how companies can work together, but also how the UK can provide solutions that the New Zealand agriculture sector needs. So a range. So two very exciting ones. One is innovative growth solutions, which is about vertical farming.
So what's vertical farming?
Vertical farming is where you are growing, you know, whether it's horticulture, but it's incredibly carefully controlled environment in terms of light and inputs, and has very, very few wasted, sort of only uses absolutely what it needs in terms of input. So really, really sort of cutting-edge technology. And the other one is called CCM, which is about carbon capture and utilization. So these are companies that are working on efficiency of agriculture, but also sustainability.
Right, and this ties into climate change, which you mentioned before.
Absolutely.
And we're going to discuss a great deal this morning. Let's go to the FTA. So what's happened overnight? There's terms of a deal between Australia and the UK have been settled upon?
Exactly. So Scott Morrison, Australian Prime Minister, has been in London. He was invited to attend the G7 meeting that's just happened. And he and the Prime Minister have agreed the broad terms of the UK-Australia free trade agreement. It will be published, the details will be published in the coming days, but that really sets out the broad parameters of what has been agreed there. And of course we have Damien O'Connor heading to London right now to accelerate progress on our free trade agreement.
To provide a context and to back up the track a little bit while these negotiations are taking place now, this is post-Brexit UK, right?
Exactly.
So essentially the UK is starting from scratch.
Yeah, exactly. So we've already done a number of free trade agreements which were essentially replicating what we had when we were part of the EU. The Australia deal is actually the first one that we've done from scratch, as will be the New Zealand one. These are sort of negotiations done absolutely from scratch, looking at what you can do on goods tariff liberalisation, what you can do on services, and what you can do in other areas of trade cooperation.
And what will the Australia one and the New Zealand one have in common? Are they similar?
They will be similar, but they'll be similar in elements, you know, in the conventional elements that you're looking at tariff liberalisation, you're looking at what you can do on services. But these are different economies, right? And they are actually very different negotiations. And there's a lot that we're trying to do in the UK-New Zealand free trade agreement on things like climate and sustainability, on indigenous trade. So they're different economies, different negotiations, and of course working to their own priorities.
And if we look at what Australia might export to the UK, in some respects it's quite different in terms of mining ore, stuff from the ground, than what New Zealand. So there is a greater, I was going to say defensiveness, that's too pejorative, but I can't think of a synonym for that offhand. But are UK farmers wary of New Zealand farmers? Does that make the FTA more complex to negotiate with New Zealand?
I would say, not necessarily. I think that there is a lot that we can do in terms of, you know, communicating the benefits of this in both countries.
What are the benefits for the UK?
So the benefits for the UK, a whole range. Of course, we have got one of the leading financial centres in the world. There's a lot that we want to do on services, financial services, things like digital, and of course on goods, you know, liberalisation of whiskey tariffs, for example, or gin.
So that's benefits for us, right? We get to drink your whiskey and your gin,
and
which
you
is
get
a good
cheaper
thing.
Whiskey
I'm
and gin.
I'm a little bit disappointed that you haven't brought any this morning.
Although we've got Seedlip, which is a non-alcoholic gin, on our stand in the Mystery Creek Pavilion. So as well as tea and scones, £100, people can try seed lip too, yes, if they want. So there are benefits on both sides.
But if you were selling the FTA, if you go back to London for a visit and you meet a farmer and they say, we don't want a bloody FTA with New Zealand, we don't want their lamb.
Yeah.
So what do you respond?
So the answer has to be about how we collaborate and cooperate between our two countries, because you've got two countries that are going to be producing top quality product, right, with really high standards, and you've got this really useful counter-seasonality. So, you know, so actually what you can do, if you get the right collaboration going between your Welsh farmer and your Waikato farmer, you can say to a third country, we can provide you this brilliant product all the way through the year. So seasons doesn't matter. You know, part of the year you'll get Welsh lamb, part of the year you'll get Waikato lamb. And so that, you know, there's a real scope for cooperation there. And the world only needs more food. And I think that's the trick. It's how do we then work together in third countries?
Fifth round has just taken place, right? Just finished.
Fifth round, exactly.
Yes.
Yeah.
I've got the report on round four of negotiations. I don't think the report on round five...
It's not out yet. No, we literally just finished early this week.
How's it going?
It's going well. We've got the broad architecture of the agreement agreed. We've provisionally closed a number of chapters. And really good dynamic, I think, in the negotiations, considering that it's all being done virtually. You know, we've not had any face-to-face negotiations, or very few. And really, really pleased that Damien O'Connor, Trade Minister and Agriculture Minister, is headed to London. He's going to have lots of talks there with our Secretary of State for Trade, with our Secretary of State for the Environment and Farming and Rural Affairs, and a number of other meetings as well.
I just was looking at the report of round four. On the final day of the round four, this is 27th of April, chief negotiators took questions from New Zealand and UK stakeholders on the negotiation. Questions covered a wide range of topics, including, and I was really interested in this one, investment disputes. Was this the sticking point of the CPTPP around corporate rights to sue governments? Is this an issue in the FTA?
So we absolutely understand New Zealand's position on that. Of course, I can't really comment on the detailed negotiation. It's also very important that you have some way of ensuring that you can resolve issues as they arise. But that's something that is under discussion. We understand where New Zealand's coming from.
So that is a particular point in this FTA?
It's something that these sorts of issues are always things that you need to cover and work out a way forward that meets everyone's needs.
So do you have a time frame? When do you think we might be matching the Australians with an agreement?
So I think, you know, I'm always wary of putting a deadline on it, because I think that you want to make really rapid progress, but you also don't want to miss opportunities along the way to really make the most of what we can do. And I think, you know, there's agreement there in New Zealand and the UK that we want to do the best possible free trade agreement. But I would hope that we'd get it done, you know, relatively rapidly. That's why Damien O'Connor has gone. And absolutely within the year would be the aspiration. But I don't want to put a deadline on it beyond that.
We so appreciate you joining us this morning. One final question. You've taken to this job like a duck to water, haven't you?
I've been in it a while now, actually. I've done 3.5 years.
And have you loved it?
Just love it. I love it. It's the breadth of what we have to talk about together. It's the connections between our countries. It's an absolute joy. Yeah.
UK High Commissioner to New Zealand, Laura Clarke, thank you so much for joining us this morning, and thank you for coming in so early. I will duck down for a seed lip and a scone later on. I really look forward to it.